braved the blizzard to get here, huh? It's funny. Yeah, that's right. I remember these snow days when I pastored a church in West Seattle. We lived in the parsonage next door to the church, so what separated my house from the church was a little driveway. And so when, on the occasion where we got a big snowstorm, we would have a decision whether or not to cancel church or not. And it was so hard for me because there, you know, I had no risk. I had to walk across the parking lot. So I'm like, yeah, let's bring it, you know. And then I thought of all the folks out there who, you know, in the congregation who would be risking their lives coming to church. So it's always a hard decision. So Kevin and Roger and I were going back and forth yesterday wondering if this was a good idea. But obviously, this snowstorm has not been as bad as some were anticipating. So I'm glad that you were able to make it. Some did make it. Vicky does our bulletin, wasn't able to do it. So I do have a note taker. There are some of my good students here in the front row. So if you want to follow along in the sermon with a note taker. I don't know if I told you this. We saw a dear lady from our church in Seattle, our West Seattle days, and she came to see us, and we hadn't seen her in, I don't know, 15 years or so. And she said, I have to show you something. And she brought this big, thick, spiral notebook this size, this little size, this half sheet size. And it was full of her notes from my sermons from 10 years. I mean, and she says she still consults them to this day, and it was just amazing. So I thought, oh, all those years of making those little half sheet flyers paid off for that dear one. So anyway, happy Valentine's Day. Okay, you bet. Got a Valentine's for you. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains but not have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Happy Valentine's. Thankful that we know love in its fullest dimension because we know God, who is love. So hope your day is special. Today we're going to sit in on a conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus as recorded in John chapter 3. So if you have a Bible, we're in John chapter 3. It really contains one of the most important passages in all of Scripture. So I'm glad you're here. I was joking with Mario on the way here thinking I was going to be preaching to like seven people, but we think we tripled that number today. Whew. Nowhere else do we find such strong statements in Scripture regarding two very important subjects. One, the new birth, or conversion, what it means to be born again. And two, what it means to be saved by faith in the Son of God. So it's impossible to be ignorant about a lot of things in religion and still be saved, but to miss what Jesus is saying here to Nicodemus in this passage before us is to be in serious trouble. Obviously, it will be review. Hey, Roger. It will be review to some, but some may learn something new, but it should lead all of us to understand more clearly and what it means to be a child of God and to appreciate more fully the salvation that Christ died to bring us. So with that, let me pray for the message, okay? Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that it steers us and gives us a path to follow in the truth. Leads to you. Thank you for your Holy Spirit who is with us and is in us and is our teacher. We pray that he would be free to speak to our hearts this morning in your word. Thank you for your presence with us. For those who couldn't be here with us this morning, bless them and may you make your presence known to them in a special way today. We thank you for this time now in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, John chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Okay. Do I need to dismiss children or anything? Kai, do I need to do anything else? You, we good? Kai was like, what am I forgetting, Kai? All right. Verse 1 of John 3, a polite greeting. Now, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And so we know that Nicodemus was a Pharisee, a religious conservative steeped in his religion. In contrast to the Sadducees, the other religious party of the day, who were less rigid in their beliefs and were more politically minded. So they were kind of like the religious liberals of the day, whereas the Pharisees were the religious conservatives. The Pharisees were the theologians. They were tied to scripture and obedience and holiness. You know, that was their tribe. Sadducees were about power and how do we appease the Romans to maintain political power in Israel. So that's what's going on here with Nicodemus. He's a ruler in the sense of he's a religious leader. As a member of the ruling council, Nicodemus would have been highly respected for his knowledge of the Hebrew scriptures and for his influence in the community. And perhaps it was his high position that led Nicodemus to approach Jesus in not in the daytime where he could be seen, but at night. He came to Jesus at night. Maybe we would use the word he was. The term that we use today is he was afraid of being canceled if he was, you know, seen with Jesus talking to this controversial rabbi. And so he comes to Jesus by night, verse 2. And in this conversation, we're soon going to see that Jesus' opinion of Nicodemus is somewhat less than flattering. But after this conversation, Nicodemus would never be the same. In fact, it would not be long after this conversation that Nicodemus would boldly stand up for Christ's innocence before a hostile Jewish council, recorded in John chapter 7. We're going to see Nicodemus stand up for Jesus' innocence in John chapter 7. A couple years later, it would be none other than Nicodemus who would assist Joseph of Arimathea in preparing the body of Christ for burial, a demonstration of ultimate respect and loyalty. It's also interesting to note that in John chapter 3, we meet Nicodemus in the dark, not only literally, but spiritually as well. But Nicodemus wouldn't stay in the dark. So Nicodemus forever stands out as a beautiful example of one who had a feeble spiritual beginning, but who finished well. You may be ashamed of your past. You may be very proud of your past. You may be doing very well in your spiritual life today. You may feel very frustrated and disappointed with yourself today. But the most important thing today is not how you've done in the past, not even how you're doing today. The most important issue is, where will you be a year from now? 2 years from now? 5 years from now? 10 years from now, if the Lord should tarry, 20 years from now. You see, the Christian life is not a 50-yard dash. It's a marathon. In my younger, lighter days, I've run 11 marathons, so I know something about of which I speak. And pacing yourself is so important. You know, the most common mistake that amateur marathon runners make is, what would you think? Starting out too fast. Absolutely. You have to be watching your watch or the clock on the side of the road and making sure that you're not starting out too fast, because you're all excited, you're ready to go, and the gun goes and you're going. And if you start out too fast, you may not make it to the end. Well, don't be discouraged if you're running at a pace that you feel it might be a bit slow. Be thankful that you're in the race for the long haul. And there's still time for you to recover if you're not happy with your progress thus far. I love what J.C. Ryle writes in his commentary. He says, the story of Nicodemus is meant to teach us that we should never despise the day of small things in religion. We must not set down a man as having no grace because his first steps toward God are timid and wavering. And the first movements of his soul are uncertain, hesitating, and stamped with much imperfection. Like I said, the Christian life in many ways is like a marathon. It's something that takes incredible effort and discipline and perseverance. But as all spiritual analogies are, this analogy is imperfect. Yes, we're in a marathon, but the fact is, we're not trained athletic runners. We're cripples. We're cripples being carried along by Jesus. That's probably a more accurate theological analogy. The Christian life is more about letting God carry you than it is about you performing well. Well, that's for another sermon. Let's return to Nicodemus and his feeble beginnings with Jesus. Verse 2b, it says, "And Nicodemus said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you've come from God as a teacher, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.'" Well, that's certainly, you know, paying Jesus considerable respect if Jesus was merely a human teacher. You see, the Pharisee is setting the bar far too low. Jesus isn't just a rabbi teaching truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He's not just a miracle worker who has God with him. He is God. Nicodemus hasn't yet asked a question, but Jesus answers him nonetheless. Verse 3, "And Jesus answered and said to him," here's his bold response, very abrupt, "'Truly, truly,'" and that's like saying, "let me level with you. I'm going to tell it to you straight, Nicodemus. Here's the truth. I say to you, unless one is born again," some translations prefer born from above, "he cannot see the kingdom of God." Now, think about the conversation thus far. Are we missing something? I mean, it feels like it, doesn't it? Yeah, it feels like something's happening between the lines that the reader's going, dude, he just like belts out this statement out of nowhere. I think the fact that Jesus was omniscient throws some of these whammies into the Gospels, where this is what you say when you know what's going on in the heart of a person. And so we don't see that. We're like, where did that come from? Well, Jesus is looking at his heart, and he's speaking to this man exactly what he needs to hear. Even though for us outsiders, we're going, whoa, okay. Well, that's how I read it. Might not fit us. Makes you feel like you're missing something in the story. But that's because Jesus is able to see past this man's respectful greeting and shoot straight for his heart. Bam. And Nicodemus isn't ready for that. He's used to playing the part of the respected expert. People come to him to find out how to get right with God. But tonight, this rabbi is the expert, and he's the preschooler. And that's how it must be for every person who comes to Christ. Leave your religious pride and your respectability and your vanity at the door. Act like you're self-sufficient and you have it all together and that you know everything, and you will miss your chance. You'll never get it. You must come to Jesus as a child, as a spiritual preschooler, or you don't come at all. And that includes Nicodemus, the religious ruler. And this elicits some questions from Nicodemus. He says, he's in his confused state, verse 4. Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he?" Oh, I've said this before, just last week. Jesus is constantly being misunderstood by people with eyes so fixed on the physical that they couldn't see spiritual realities. What was last week's confusion? Can you remember that far last week? What did Jesus say in John 2, end of John 2, that people just kind of missed? Remember when he said, destroy this temple, I'll raise it up in 3 days? They went down the literal path. Same thing here. Nicodemus saying, born again? I've already been born. How can I be born a second time? Exactly. He's missing the point. Ridiculous. Grown up being born again. Again, we know what it means. It's a phrase that's common in our vernacular, born again. It's a spiritual reality. But Nicodemus is hearing it for the first time, and he's thinking, what are you talking about, born again? Jesus isn't sidetracked by this man's mockery. He's going to drive home his point with yet another veiled statement. Verse 5, Jesus answered, I'm going to tell it to you straight, or truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. We could spend a lot of time discussing what Jesus meant by water here. I will be brief. Some see water as referring to physical birth, water being the amniotic fluid in the womb. And so they see Jesus saying here that you need to be born physically and then spiritually. That's true. I just don't think that that's what Jesus' point is here. I agree with those who see Jesus using the term water here in a way that Nicodemus would be familiar with, since Jesus' ministry came forth shortly after John the Baptizer's ministry, who stressed the necessity of repentance and cleansing, signified by what? Baptism with water. And then the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit, that's the baptism of the Holy Spirit that Jesus came to usher. Jesus is probably saying to Nicodemus, unless you repent, symbolized by water baptism, and believe in me, and thus receive the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. How are we saved? We're saved by repentance and faith. And the sign of that, and the validation of that reality, is being baptized or placed into the life of the Spirit by water and by Spirit. He's talking about regeneration. He's talking about coming to Christ, repenting, and being born again. And then he says, verse 6, driving home this statement that is pregnant with truth, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Well, we can see that the flesh represents human effort. What man can do apart from God. And that's what Nicodemus is all about. Not intentionally, but he's doing his darn best to earn God's acceptance by living a good, moral, religiously observant life. There are a lot of people today who are doing the same thing. I don't know, 2,000 years, and we still don't get this right. You know, I'm a hospice chaplain. I go every day talking to people who are on the verge of, you know, death's door. And I talk about, do you have peace with God? And, you know, and if the conversation goes in that direction, they invariably say something about, well, I've tried to live a good life. That's the flesh. You've tried. Jesus says, Nicodemus, that's not going to cut it. You're trying to fix in the flesh, in other words, in your own good works, something that only God can fix through the Spirit. This obviously is referring to how a person comes to Christ initially, but the fact is, it applies to all of our lives. All of us tend to fall back to the error of thinking that it's up to us to please God and earn his acceptance or maintain his acceptance by our own religious performance. the Galatians were doing that. Paul had to deal with this issue with the church at Galatia, and he writes in Galatians 3:3, are you so foolish? Having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? That's what Jesus means when he says that which is flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. He's saying stop trying to win God's approval by your own good works in your flesh. What Paul said to the Galatians, 2,000 years ago, he could say to us today, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. The Spirit must bear his fruit in your life. Yeah, good works. What is it? You're not saved by good works, but you won't be saved without them, because the fruit of salvation is good works, right? It's a changed life, right? So, especially liberal readers of the Bible, they'll say that Paul and James, disagreed with each other, because Paul championed this idea of salvation by grace through faith alone, right? And then James writes this right strawy epistle, according to Martin Luther, who says, we are justified not by faith, but also by works. Oh, thanks, James. Did you have to include that? James and Paul, they were writing on the same subject from different angles, right? This is free. This is not in the notes. Paul is in the house looking at the fire. And he's saying, there's evidence that there's a fire in the fireplace because I'm looking at it right now. James is down the street and he's looking at the chimney going, I know there's a fire in that house because there's smoke coming out of the chimney, right? I know it. I can't see it, but I know it's there because of what it's producing out the chimney. That's the controversy. A child can understand that one, right? And that's what Paul and James are disagreeing about. They're just looking at faith from different perspectives. One, Paul is in there talking about faith, what it truly is, and how without that you are not saved. You're not saved by the smoke. You're saved by the flames of the fire, right? James is saying, if there's no smoke coming out of the chimney, there's no fire in the fireplace. Damn, all right, that was free. You bet. Free. All right, let me get back to verse 7. Jesus goes on and says, do not be amazed that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. You can't see it, but it's there. The Greek word pneuma means both wind and spirit. And we use the word pneuma today, pneumatic brakes, must be air brakes, right? There's that Greek word pneuma, and it means breath, wind, spirit, it's all those synonyms. So Jesus' point is just like the blowing of the wind is a sovereign, mysterious work of God, it is also the sovereign, mysterious work of God when the Spirit blows upon a person's soul at the moment of conversion. Yes, he's invisible. Yes, you can't see him. But just like the physical wind, you certainly see its effects. What a lesson this must have been for a man who had been brought up with the belief that a person could and should save himself by observance to the law of Moses and to a host of man-made, visible, concrete human regulations. This is just a different game. This is different. For the Jews, it's concrete. It's black and white. Here it is. And Jesus is talking about a mystery that you can't see, but you kind of know it's there, but it's something that you're not in control of, and you really can't always see it. So, naturally, Nicodemus said to him, verse 9, how can these things be? Jesus answered and said to him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and you do not understand these things?" It's possible to be very, very knowledgeable in religion, and even very knowledgeable about the Bible, and still be very, very lost. Coming to Christ usually means having to deal with some very painful realities about yourself. And so I'm sure that Jesus' words to Nicodemus were hard to hear. He's upbraiding, he's scolding Nicodemus. And yet we have to believe that Jesus' words were so because Jesus loved this man enough to tell him the truth. We are so afraid of offending people today, aren't we? Afraid of saying the wrong thing? Afraid of hurting people's opinions of themselves? If it was today, Nicodemus would have said, "I find that offensive." But Jesus simply said these things not to hurt him, but to help him. "Nicodemus, you claim to be a teacher of the law. You should know these things. And you don't." He says in verse 11, "Truly, truly, I say to you, we," now who's the "we" there? Well, some people say that Jesus could be referring to himself and John the Baptist at that point, or he might have been referring to his Father, himself, the Holy Spirit. He could be a veiled reference to the Trinity. He's using "we," first person plural, not just me, but "we." "We speak of what we know and testify of what we have seen, and you do not accept our testimony. If I told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you heavenly things?" So he told them earthly things. He told them about birth. He talked about the wind. He's trying to use earthly imagery, analogies, to communicate these truths. "No one has ascended into heaven but he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man." Gosh, this is so... I feel sorry for Nicodemus. I'm like, how is he going to get this? Jesus is highlighting to Nicodemus his absolute qualifications to speak on these matters. Jesus didn't read this stuff in a book. He wasn't just taught by it at rabbinical school. He didn't take a correspondence course on how to start your own religious movement. He had firsthand information about the heavenly realities to which he was referring to. And they were so insanely out there that a natural mind couldn't get it. Jesus was at the table in God's throne room when these decisions were being made. You know, we all have our own ideas about God and salvation. Where do we get these ideas? Usually, it's a hodgepodge mixture of concepts and sound bites that we've heard along the way, heard on the street, in school, things that we've inherited from family traditions, things that we maybe have seen on TV or read in magazines or books, and of course, things that we kind of make sense in our own mind. That's how we get our religious knowledge. Isn't it amazing that people can rest their eternal destiny on such a collection of unreliable resources? And if God hadn't intervened in our lives and opened our eyes to the truth, those would still be the sources that would be giving us information about God and eternity. My friend, the Bible clearly warns us that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. I am betting my life and my eternal destination on belief that Jesus had the authority to speak on these subjects, that Jesus knew what he was talking about. That's the bottom line. When I talk to people in hospice care who want to talk about their souls And sometimes they'll say, well, what do you believe? The way I get to the point is I say this. I believe that Jesus' words were true. I believe that Jesus was not lying. He wasn't a lunatic. I believe he was speaking truth. That's why I trust him for my salvation. He's my hope in life and in death. It's all about the question, did Jesus have the authority to say these things? And here Jesus is telling Nicodemus, we speak of that which we know, we. Jesus isn't acting alone, Father, Son, and Spirit. He has authority. He can be trusted. He knows more about life and death and heaven and hell and God than I do, more than any person who ever lived has done. Are you trusting in his word? What source of authority are you going to for ultimate truth? Well, you're coming to this church, so I'm assuming you're going, you are believing the words of Christ, right? Gosh, and it makes a difference in your life, doesn't it? Doesn't it? Think about it. If you didn't believe in the authority of Christ, where would you be? That's the issue, man. If you have not received Christ by faith as the way, the truth, and the life, I implore you to consider his authority. Consider his words. He will not turn away anyone who comes to him by faith. All right, verses 14 and 15, wrapping it up. Type and antitype. Verse 14, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. Oh my gosh. Now Jesus is, I think, here connecting with Nicodemus, because this reference is from the book of Numbers. Nicodemus probably had this book memorized, literally, and they memorized scripture. He probably knew exactly chapter and verse of what Jesus is referring to. In Numbers 21, verses 6 to 9, when the Israelites were wandering in the wilderness, and God sent a plague of snakes to punish the people for their rebellion. But God also provided a remedy for the poisonous snake bites. He told Moses to erect a pole upon which he was to attach a bronze snake. And those bitten by those poisonous snakes would only have to look up and see the snake, the bronze figure, to be healed of their snake bite, to survive. And their healing came when they looked upon this lifted up bronze snake. Theologians call that serpent a type. A type of Christ, really a foreshadow of the reality to come. Jesus is the antitype. In other words, he is the fulfillment of the type. He's the real deal. And Jesus used this incident to picture the coming salvation of his work that he would procure by dying on the cross. Where the, you know, he's referring to the cross where the victim was literally lifted up on a cross. Lifted up. And it would also come to speak of his subsequent glorification when Jesus would be lifted up into the heavens during his ascension, right, to the heavens. So lifted up. It's foreshadowing an event that had not taken place. The perishing Israelites only had to look up at this bronze snake lifted high to live. That's all they had to do. They didn't have to really reform their lives and start, you know, turning over a new leaf. They just have to look up and see. And they're lifting up their eyes to see it is their way of saying, I need your mercy, O God. You know, how much pride is there in that? How'd you get healed by the snake bite? I looked up. What a great guy I am. I looked up. There's no pride in that. It's so simple. In the same way, salvation happens when a sinner looks up to Jesus, believing that God will save him. God has provided this way for us to be healed of sin's deadly bite. And just as the Israelites had their physical lives spared by looking up to God's remedy, so the souls of believers are saved, are spared by looking up to God's remedy, Jesus. By the way, the bronze snake, did that bronze snake have the power to save those Israelites? Only Christ saves. Even Old Testament believers, they are all saved by the work of Christ. It just hadn't happened yet. But that qualified. That was a placeholder, if you will. They would be saved by the death and resurrection of Jesus just like we are. It just hadn't happened yet. And so they had to look at the type first. But it was Christ's death that was applied to their account. Christ died for all of humanity, all the sins, past, present, future, right? Next week, we're going to look at John chapter 3, verse 16. You probably know that verse. It's going to be a good one. It's as Jesus continues this conversation between himself and Nicodemus at night. Let me close by foot stomping some points to ponder as we are dismissed. Okay, A, conversion is a radical change. That's what I see in this text. It's a radical change. Becoming a Christian is not a slight or superficial change. It's not walk-in surgery. I had my hip replaced 2 years ago. Yeah. And I didn't stay the night in the hospital. They broke off my hip, took it out, and put an artificial one in and sewed it up, and I went home the same day. So that's pretty crazy. There are surgeries that are more serious that you couldn't brag that about. Like I would think open heart surgery would be one of those surgeries that you're in the hospital for a long time. Well, the surgery that God does is greater than any of those things. It's radical. It's not merely a little tweaking of your soul. It's not just reformation. It's resurrection. It's a radical change. It's not just an outward change. It's a change of the heart, of the will, of character. It's not just taking up religion, it's being taken up by Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation, a new creature. The word, the Greek word in that phrase is metamorphosis is the Greek word. And we learn in grade school what metamorphosis is. It's the process of a caterpillar making a cocoon and coming out a different creature. Wings, it's beautiful, it's colorful, it's a butterfly, right? That's the word, the Greek word that Paul uses in 2 Corinthians 5:17. I love that. Conversion is a radical change. It is a tragedy of untold proportions for a new Christian to underestimate the significance of his or her conversion. That's what I see in the text here. It's a radical change. B, conversion is a sovereign work of God. Conversion is a sovereign work of God. Some may disagree with me here, but I believe that conversion is a sovereign work of God. A baby in the womb is not, doesn't create itself. Baby's just going along for the ride. A baby is experiencing it. They're there, but they're not the author of their own existence, right? We may as well expect a dead man to give himself life as to expect a natural man to make himself spiritual. Here's how Paul puts it in Ephesians 2. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. but God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Conversion is a sovereign work of God. C, conversion is a result of faith. That's what Nicodemus had to learn in this conversation. The man is not justified, is not made right with God by his works. You know, I wonder if there were anyone, those who were bitten by those poisonous snakes, who just were too proud to look up, who were just too stubborn to obey Moses. Maybe some just said, you know, that's too easy. I don't believe it. How could we be saved from this poison by just looking up? I don't buy it. Maybe some keeled over and died because they refused to believe in the solution that God was offering. The message of the cross is too easy. It's foolishness to a proud man who insists on being the captain of his ship, master of his soul. It says to a religious man, your good works are a stench to me. There is nothing you can do to earn salvation. It is a gift that I will give to anyone who is willing to admit that they've been bitten by the sting of sin, and all they have to do, God says, is look up to me. If you are not saved, I implore you, look up to Jesus on the cross and believe that that is God's way for you to be saved from sin's poison. You must be born again. D. Conversion produces visible results. I see that in the text. Jesus says the wind blows where it wishes. You're not in control of it. You can't see it, but you can hear its sound. You can see its effects. In other words, salvation is sovereign. You're not in control of it. It's God. God's in control of it. It's incomprehensible. You can't explain it all. It's a mysterious work of God. But its effects can always be seen, always known. The new birth can't be hidden. It's like the old Sunday school song, if you're saved and you know it, then your life will surely show it. Thank you, Rebecca. And your life will surely show it. How will it show us? How will it show itself? One, you will love God and you will love people. Love is the primary evidence of true saving faith. Didn't I read that in 1 Corinthians 13? You can have all the other things going for you. If you have not love, God counts your religion as a zero. If you don't love, you don't know God. It's as simple as that. All sin is fundamentally a failure to love God and or people. Number two, what will be the visible signs of faith? Humility. You will be a humble person. You will know that you don't deserve God's love. And you'll tend to look at others with compassion rather than pride that you're better than them. You will honestly confess your sin, and you'll be sorry about failing to obey God. And if you're too proud to admit your sin and your dependence upon grace, you're a stranger to God. Because if you know God, if you have faith, you're humble. And finally, your life will bear fruit. As imperfect as you are, the fruit of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, it'll come out. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not realize that Christ Jesus is in you? Unless, of course, you fail the test. All right. How many of you remember, I'm going to close with this, the old advertising slogan from Clairol's women's hair color?
It's going to date some of us.
Does she or doesn't she? Anyone remember that? Old. You don't? Does she or doesn't she? Oh, man. Classic 60s. Let me tell you a story about Shirley Polakoff, one of only five women inducted into the Advertising Hall of Fame. She's renowned around the world for that simple ad that she wrote for Clairol, taken directly from her personal life. This landmark ad, does she or doesn't she, changed an entire generation's attitude toward hair color, and sales went up 413% in 6 years. That's a good advertising slogan. She came up with that slogan back in 1933, just before marrying her husband. Her fiancé had invited her over to meet the family for Passover dinner. And there was this, during the Depression, when times were tough and no one was good enough for George in his mother's eyes. On the way home in the car, Shirley asked her fiancé George how he thought she did with his mom. And he told her that his mother said she painted her hair. And Shirley felt humiliated. In her mind, she could hear her future mother-in-law, does she color her hair or doesn't she? During the 50s, hair coloring products were still not acceptable for, quote, nice girls. Only about 7% of women used hair coloring at this time, and those women were usually models, actresses, maybe a few career girls, and those we would known as fast women. And so in 1955, Shirley had become one of the first women in advertising, and she was working on one of the hardest campaigns to sell in the industry, because not only did she have to change how women thought about hair color, they had a lot of obstacles to overcome with family and society, societal approval. And she writes, it became increasingly apparent to me that everything about the campaign would have to stress the naturalness, a naturalness surrounded by an aura of great respectability. She's going to change the minds of the population with this advertising slogan. And it's then that Shirley remembered the lines her mother-in-law had spoken so many years previously, which became her choice slogan, does she or doesn't she? Only your hairdresser knows for sure, right? That got it. Clairol accepted those words, but they included the words so natural before the tagline. So it read, so natural, only your hairdresser knows for sure. Now, aren't you glad you came to church to learn that? You're welcome. My friend, there is a grand problem in the church today. It's that far too many professing believers show no signs of true spiritual life. Their Christianity is a secret. One could say that they are Clairol Christians. Only God knows for sure. My friend, if you're a Christian, there ought to be something that is not natural about you. Your love for Christ, your humility, your love for others, your willingness to take a stand for Jesus even when it's not popular or convenient. If you're saved and you know it, then your life will surely show it. If you are born again, then cultivate that relationship. Be filled with the Spirit. Let him bear his fruit in your life. If you are not born again, no amount of religion will save you. You must be born again. Let's pray. Thank you for this time, oh God. Thank you for our freedom that we have to assemble together in this place and worship. Hear your word preached. Lord, we pray for freedom for people around the world who have none. Pray for healing of our land from this pandemic. We pray for peace and civility in our streets. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to be not just hearers, but doers of your precious word today. We pray in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
The words on the third verse are a little bit different, just to prepare you for that. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Help them to see you in what I think, Lord. Help them to see you in what I speak, Lord. Help them to see you in what I do, Lord. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Night of April 8th, 1978, I came forward at an altar call for that song. And I came forward because I made a decision. But I made a decision because the Spirit, the wind was blowing and wooing me. That's the mysterious work of God in conversion. Well, God bless you. Thank you for coming. Go forth into the streets of this world. May you go with the memory of this hour when you refresh your souls in the presence of God and his people. May you go with the intent to carry his love and extend it to your family and your friends and everyone you meet along the way who are in need. Go with the courage, with the resolve not to sin, and go with the exciting reminder that any moment Jesus may come again. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.